Welcome back, everybody, to the TI4 European Qualifier. We got this time around Team Coast Gaming going up against Relax. You are doing fine. And despite what you guys think, I am doing fine. Dog actually paid me a visit between... The Mouse Sports guys actually paid me a visit between the little break. Talked to them for a little bit. Got myself some caffeine. And I'm going to be joined by a co-caster. Things are looking good, man. Things are looking good. Honestly, last game was just disappointing. Watching Aware Gaming had the whole entire early game, like, they were making all these good movements, they were doing everything they needed to do, and so many inexperienced teams do this, too. They do everything right going up into the early game, and then they get into the mid game, and it's a failure of execution. They don't execute the plan that should be in place. First of all, the lack of a Lincoln's pickup, bit of a problem there from Weaver, but that could have been recovered just fine. Like, the BKB, turn it into some five-man push, man, but they just never took it. Instead, they got picked off a couple times. Because, you know, the gyrocopter, what is that, a gold advantage? And they can't really recover from that. If Weaver was at the same amount of gold as the gyrocopter, I think they could have had that match, but they just let the game stall out too much, and Virtus Pro were managed to just turtle out, wait until the Lycan and the gyrocopter just got too huge to be able to handle. So guys, let's jump into this next game. Draft is coming up, and I gotta welcome in my co-caster Durka is gonna be joining me once again after several hours of having lunch. He says,
"Yeah, I had two lunches."
Okay then.
I had quesadilla and then I had McDonald's.
It's
crude.
Wait, I'm trying to figure out that if that is that a euphemism?
Is that a euphemism? Did I have Mexico?
Is McDonald's and
a Mexican than an American?
I wasn't gonna say it, but yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking.
No, I didn't have breakfast, so I had early lunch and then early dinner.
What are you, a hobbit now?
It was good. What do you mean? What? Hobbits have like 7 meals
a day.
First
we have first lunch and then second lunch
and then second lunch. Reserve time. Well, I missed breakfast and then second breakfast and then I missed brunch and then I missed first lunch. So I had to have all four of those meals at once to become second lunch. And then instead of having second lunch and supper and dinner, I've just had the third lunch. So now I'm not going to have dinner or supper or a midnight snack.
Until later, of course. You'll still have those. They'll just be delayed, right?
Oh, yeah. I'll stay up until 3 a.m.
I'm just imagining you like a cow, just like constantly munching on something.
Grazing
now.
Grazing just like, on food. Just get me a trough of, you know, an assortment of food and I'll just sit there going, oh no, no, no.
All right, let's talk about this draft, shall we? We got Axe Sand King and Batrider and Centaur were the first couple of bans coming out. I love the Axe Respect ban going up against Relax Gaming. The second set of bans was the Darkseer and Puck by Coast, while the Doom and Dragonite were banned away by Relax. Makes sense to ban away those big tanky heroes when you pick up a Marana. That is a big downside of the Marana, is when you're dealing with those tanks, your lack of damage ends up kind of betraying you going into the mid-game.
Tide is so... Oh my... Oh, they picked Viper as well. Oh, no.
Yep.
Like, Tide is such an annoying hero now, that Kraken Shell.
Mm-hmm.
When you've got heroes like Marana and Wisp, and Rubick as well, who do very little physical right-click damage. I remember playing a game where we wiped the enemy team, and there was a Tidehunter left on like 150 health, and there were three of us chasing him. We hit him about 20 times in total, and he just wouldn't die. Because he kept getting Kraken Shell procs, Stout Shield procs, remaining. And just sort of like, okay, I'm going to Anchor Smash you as well, so you have 40% less attack damage. Oh, 60% remaining. Now. What are you going to do? And the great thing about Tide, you can play him more effectively in the offlane solo now, if you have someone or himself stacking the Ancients, because that Anchor Smash and Kraken Shell means that he can take sort of 3 or 4 stack of Ancients without taking any damage, mm-hmm. and with using limited HP and mana. Whereas, you know, Beastmaster or Tinker, they take a lot of time having to regen on mana, having to use Sol Ring for axes and March of the Machines. He can, you know, use Anchor Smash, what, four or five times when he's level maybe 6?
Anchor Smash is ridiculous now. 60% damage reduction? Man. Any melee hero is just so crushed by that. It's ridiculous. Mixing in with the Kraken Shell like you were talking about earlier is just ridiculous. Timbersaw's, though, going to be grabbed by Relax. That's a hero that we have not seen in quite some time, and a fun hero to watch at that. 10
seconds remaining. Yeah, definitely. I mean, Centaur's banned out, but one of the reasons Tide sort of came back was because Centaur was such a popular pick. And when you put Tide against Centaur, this hero who usually excels in a 1v2 or a 1v3 lane, getting experience, running up and using his double-edged Tranquil Boots to heal back up, Tidehunter pushes him out of the lane, forces him to buy salves and stuff like that. But a Timbersaw, I just wonder if they match up 1v1, where they have two solo laners, then they've got Viper, Disruptor, Treant in possibly an aggressive tri-lane. Because we've seen from a couple of teams, Team Hehe and Coast, I think Hehe had the Wisp, Treant, Viper, didn't they?
Yes, they did. They were the ones running the Wisp, Treant, Protector that rolled over a team that I can't remember. Maybe it was Ocelot Gaming. I think it might have been. Yeah, but yeah, they're the ones that had like something ridiculous, like 8 kills by the 8-minute mark or something.
And that was all on the Treant and Wisp, but Viper was just sitting there farming.
Yeah, pretty much. Radiant team. So Brewmaster now going to be banned away by Relax. Oh, man. I mean, I'm just looking at the Team Coast lineup. That is so hard to kill those heroes. Like, the first two pickups, the Treant Protector and the Tide, natural tanks. The Viper, tanky as all hell, despite the fact that he's a ranged agility hero. He is actually very, very tanky. And the Disruptor, yeah, I mean, he's sitting way in the back, so you're probably not going to catch him out too much. He's also going to be a good counter to the Marana, Wisp, and the Timbersaw. None of those heroes want to be building into a really fast BKB, so that Static Storm is going to do work against them. And if you have the right timing with the Disruptor, it could absolutely destroy Wisp relocates.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. But we had this conversation before where Wisp has changed from being, you know, a pairing with one specific hero to being more of a utility hero, where you have a couple of heroes he can relocate, or you use him to escape more than you do now to bring tiny Chaos Knight into a fight after they've been split pushing. And Morphling, he's been coming back really strongly recently. I'm still not a big fan because of how long it takes him to get the items he needs, especially if you go Lincolns first or Midas Lincolns. You still don't have a great amount of damage or split push or team fight potential. You know, you've got nothing that you really want from your carry 25 minutes into the game. Mm-hmm. You've got to wait for that Ethereal Blade, then, you know, Skadi, Butterfly, those bigger items to come 40 minutes in. Do they have a plan to bring him in earlier? Or do they have enough space-making ability with a Timbersaw, Rubick, Wisp, Mirana to give him that time?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was about to say. Is I was going to ask if you felt a little bit better because we're running Mirana here as sort of a semi-carry, plus Timbersaw is a great hero that comes online. They both come online about that 18 to 25-minute mark. They're going to be able to do a lot of work there. My only concern is Team Coast. They seem to have this sort of like 5-man lineup. They just sort of run at you. They don't have like this amazing amount of pushing power. They don't have the biggest initiation until they have the Blink Dagger on Tide. But their whole entire lineup just kind of feels like, you can't kill us, and we're just going to run at you. And you either have to get the hell out of the way and go split push somewhere, or you're going to have to hide underneath your towers and hope that's going to be enough to change it. Because I feel like Team Ghosts are just going to aim for some really early lane control and push down some early towers with like the Viper pickup. I don't know. Their whole entire lineup is just kind of odd.
It's like a bulldozer. You've got no finesse. You've got no real sort of strategy. It's just going to be bulldozer.
Yeah.
Run at the enemy. Make sure that living armor is on whoever they focus. Have Tidehunter Ravage. Viper, you know, spam his poison on people. The only real thing is going to be Disruptor and getting a nice combo off there. But Invoker, well, I was saying there's no finesse. All of a sudden, Invoker's picked up, completely changes it.
So, what does this mean? Does it mean this mean we're going to see an aggro try with the Disruptor, Viper, Treant Protector, Tidehunter in the safe lane, and Invoker mid? I'm not too big of a fan of the Viper in tri-lane scenarios, except when you want to run it aggressively, because Viper is such a strong laner that gimping his experience in exchange for having a really strong laning presence against another tri-lane, I think is worth it. I know other players do disagree. They feel that Viper is a worthless hero if you run him in any sort of tri-lane scenario. But oftentimes those players also think Viper is pretty useless in general. So,
yeah, I think with we were talking about the Mirana tri-lane previously, and with that, you know, you can have the two supports rotate off the lane if you don't get in too many kills. And you can leave the Mirana there solo, and she can do fine. Whereas with the Viper tri-lane, you really are committing to getting kills and possibly getting that tier 1 tower very early on. And you can't leave Viper down there alone against, you know, heroes like Rubick, Wisp, and Morphling, because he's going to get shredded. He doesn't have any natural escape ability. All he's going to rely on is corrosive skin, which isn't a skill you take in an aggressive tri-lane, necessarily. You want to go for the nether toxin and your poison attack. What's going on?
If you didn't notice, we had mass disconnects from almost every single caster, as well as the admin. And the players paused and they're like, what the hell? What's going on? And I told them, I was like, I'm good, guys. Don't. I'm good, so don't worry about it. And Ape Mother's like, well, Cap is here, so let's go.
Let's do this.
Oh, man. I'm kind of... I feel kind of bad because I just screwed the other streams, but it made me giggle, so it's good. It's all good. Okay, I really have become the Joker.
I'm glad I read Twitch chat every once in a while. Someone just pointed out, what does Rubik steal?
He steals Viper Strike.
And?
Like, he might steals steal Ravage? Ravage? What do you mean? No, He's got plenty of abilities to steal.
In how many situations does Rubik steal Ravage?
TI2 situations?
Okay, percentage-wise, 5% of Ravage is going to get stolen when the Rubik's on the enemy team?
I think it's a little higher than that. I would say, really? I would give it at least 10%, if not 15 to 20.
Well, when a Tide is going to Ravage, very rarely does he have low mana. He's either in a position where he's being initiated on, which is going to be the Rubik in range of the Ravage, or he's going to be running into a situation where Rubik is there to be Ravaged, and he's always, almost always, going to get Anchor Smash off. Very rarely is that Ravage going to be stolen. I agree with Viper Strike, but maybe Glimpse or Static Storm.
Yeah, he's got any of the Invoker abilities, which are all good. He's got Living Armor potentially away from the tree, which like basically destroys the purpose of picking up a tree. If you can snag the Living Armor when you're facing a tree, perfect. You got the Ravage, you got the Viper Strike, you got the Static Storm, any Invoker's abilities. I mean, they're all decent. They're all decent abilities to steal. And just the option of maybe you do steal that Ravage and make the big plays. You know, Chuan style, let's do it. Oh, look at this aggression, though. Oh, Dread, he's going to have to toss him back. He didn't actually get the stun onto the Tidehunter, and that may cost him his life. Good body blocking there from Tame My Wild. And the surprise gank there from Steph Style. I'm surprised he didn't pick up a Boots with that kind of plan.
Yeah, and up on top lane, the Timbersaw took, what, about 300-400 damage from the Disruptor and the Viper. So both of these lanes under heavy aggression, they really got to watch their step and where they're going. Morphling mid against the Invoker, same kind of story. He's got to watch very carefully his positioning and how he uses waveform and morph. Because once E skills, wow. I don't know why that was so difficult for my brain to register what that actually said. Once the Invoker gets Cold Snap up, which is going to be level 3, most likely, unless he goes for a second in Exort, that Morphling is going to have a pretty rough time.
Yeah, this double melee lane is pretty funny because they just don't have damage. I love this idea of running the Tidehunter with the Terrain Protector. It's two of the like tankiest heroes early on in the laning phase against a Mirana with no real damaging supports. Like the Wisp and the Rubik are super passive. So they're just like, the Rubik does very, very little in damage. The Spirit Balls coming out from the Wisp are situationally good, but not always that reliable source of damage. It's not like a quick, easy nuke. So Windex is actually going to be laning in middle lane with Warf lane. I think that's for the best. I actually kind of want to see him doing a little bit more stacking of the hard camp, not spending so much time in the laning phase, and just coming in and just healing up Morphling whenever he needs it.
Yeah. Did we see if Lich was banned in the draft?
I don't...
Oh, mid lane?
Think so. I don't remember. Yeah, jump in. E-skill's getting a little bit low here. That Cold Snap doing a lot of work, though, and here comes that regen. Kicking into play a little bit for Yoki. And they do get E-skills away, so he's going to be fine. Meanwhile, the dive at bottom lane. They're going to go for Dread here. The follow-up. Lead seat not going to be able to land. Well done by Dread getting that telekinesis at the right time. Tame by Wild. They can't go on him because he's still got the leap up. So they're dealing with this aggression, but at the same time, Solon is still picking up a good amount of experience from this lane and even a couple of last hits as well.
Yeah, I was just thinking that Titan, the Treant pick is great and all, and it's a very tanky hero, can get up in the face of the Mirana and the Rubik. But if they had a Lich down here instead, they'd be pulling the lane back. They'd have Frost Blast and Sacrifice, giving experience to the Tidehunter. And I love running Lich in dual lanes, So you've got Lich Centaur, Lich Tidehunter, that kind of thing, where you're giving extra experience to your offlaner. You can stack the Ancients for them, mm-hmm. and you've also got that extra slow and nuke damage from Frostblast. That's why Lich is one of these supports which doesn't really fulfill the normal support role. Steph style might be in a bit of trouble. Arrow flying out, gets living armor on himself. Is he actually... He can't die here. He's fine.
Yeah, at least they force out a health potion out of him and actually managed to cancel it, so... Nice little play there from Relax, getting a little bit extra damage, a little bit more room for them.
Denied.
And the bigger thing that Shoshlo is having a kind of rough time. He's still picking up plenty of experience here. He just can't get close to the Viper is the biggest issue. He got a lot of CS early on, but now he's kind of stagnated out, and that's not a big surprise against a Viper. You're not going to get a whole lot. Look at this big old stack, though.
Does he try and take it or just pull it?
I think he just tries and pulls it, and if they like intercept it or anything like that, he just hugs near close enough to get the share half the experience.
Well, the thing is, they can't really take it, so it's going to deny the creeps unless they pull the creeps away from it, which is really mm-hmm. difficult. Because there's no way that a Viper can try and take that three stack.
Oh, no, absolutely not. Maybe they can get some of their smaller creeps last hit or something like that, but... You're right. There's no way, easy way for them to clear through it. They could be up for the Tidehunter later on, though. If the Timbersaw isn't, if he gets level 6 or higher levels, he might manage to be able to snag it. But that could be a little bit of farming for the Tidehunter later on, as he wants to maybe finish up his Blink Dagger, gets a little bit close to that one. Go up to that top lane, farm up a stack with the permanent Anchor Smash being spammed out.
I really like this Wisp Morph mid against the Invoker especially. And they know that Coast are doing dual lanes, so the Wisp has had complete free reign of the runes. So every time he's gone to a rune, he's got it, and they've got pretty decent warding up seeing as well. So that means Morphling is overall winning this lane against the Invoker pretty damn easily. He's got triple the Invoker's CS.
Yeah, just the Wisp, that regen, allowing you to go full agility just constantly. And, even an Exord Invoker can't contest with that kind of high damage. Especially with the possibility that if you overextend yourself, you're going to get waveformed and also slowed up by the tether. And a lot of right-click damage coming your way. You just can't possibly actually turn and fight the Morphling, despite the fact that he's so weak with so much, so little strength.
When you're this far behind, as an Invoker, do you still go Midas? Because a lot of
yes,
the time...
Yes, always.
Always?
I'm a big fan of always picking up the Midas on the SF, the Wraith King, and the Invoker. I don't know, man. It's all about the experience for me, for the Invoker.
Yeah. I have to agree in like 90% of the cases. Occasionally, you'll see players like Dendi realize, I'm zero. Like, the Invoker hasn't died, which is probably the main thing here. Midas is still viable. But if, you're sort of 0-3 as an Invoker, maybe 8 minutes in, you're desperately trying to get the Midas. Going for a 4-staff or something is going to be much more important. Trying to escape from, Timbersaw, Morphling, Wisp relocating in. If it gets to that stage, but we'll see what he decides.
Yeah, that's true. In my opinion, you just pick up the hand of Midas afterwards.
4-staff Midas.
30-minute Midas, no problem.
So that's the thing. 7 minutes in, Morphling has Wraithband Midas boots.
Yeah, he's...
You can't compete with that.
You really can't. We also almost have Arcane Boots up for the Timbersaw, as well as level 6. Things really turn around for Timbersaw once he has both of those requirements. So you may see him actually try and pop that stack soon. Like, he won't be able to get all of it. He'll probably take a large amount of damage and probably most of his mana pool to clear through most of these creeps, but I think it'll be well worth it just to deprive Coast of that opportunity. See another pull going down once again. Timbersaw gonna force this lane back, and I think this is up to like Freegalit. This is something that when you are on the dire side, supports have that extra duty that they have to perform here. Timbersaw's gonna get caught here. He can't Timber Chain away because he's just gonna get glimpsed back
really?
Just
nice.
Like that.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Beautiful timing. The Moonlight Shadow came out a little bit late though. I think Tame My Wild could have saved him.
Yeah, no sentries or anything up here on this top lane. But that glimpse timing, just waiting, now. Now is my time to strike. Viper's not doing too badly against this stack of creeps. That level 4 corrosive skin.
Yeah, a lot of teams, a lot of players have been really favoring the early, early levels of corrosive skin, even in situations where you're not copping any early harassment damage. It's not like the Timber Saw is getting in your face at all. They just really like the magic reduction going into the laning phase, as well as obviously the poison does a lot of work as well. So,
but I guess he's going to get free last hits no matter what he does, so he doesn't need Nether Toxin. Mm-hmm. Harassment's going to be limited because Timber Saw is going to, you know, chain away or sit just in XP range. And they want to fight soon. He's got mech, so in the next 3 minutes or so, what level's Tide? Tide has just hit level 6. So now is the time to start fighting. They could go down on this bot lane, try and stop this Marana getting any further farm after phase boots. Or they could start pressuring this top tier 1, push Timber Saw completely out of lane. He can try and jungle, but it's a difficult task. And then, once you push Timbersaw out of lane, destroy that tier 1 top. That creates an opening for you to then go onto the mid lane to harm that Morphling. And
yeah,
Treant has been sitting mid.
Yeah, he's been just kind of hanging out, picking up some experience while we have the Invoker actually full-time jungling with his Forge Spirits. Which is, I really like to see when teams do this. Really prioritizing their supports, because these cores can go into the jungle when they get level 7, level 8, and they can jungle just as much and just as fast as laning would. You know, they get just as much experience, just as much gold, and so being able to give one of your supports some solo time to get there faster, level 6, level 7, can actually make a big difference as you start making that transitional phase.
Yeah. But some teams do it out of strategy. Some teams have to do it out of necessity. Like here, the Invoker can't sit mid. Treant can. So Invoker has been forced into the jungle. It's a cause. It's a symptom. It's not the actual problem. Well, the problem is causing it. That Morphling and Wisp pushed the Invoker out of lane.
I do agree with you, though. I believe they should be trying to use this Tidehunter Ravage. Just go for a simple pickoff. Like, I don't care if it's just like Tidehunter making a surprise Ravage onto the Marana and then picking her off and turning into an early tier 1 tower, because this Tidehunter just needs a little bit of help for them to start taking these towers so he can get the gold for a Blink Dagger. And any small rotation will help. I just don't like seeing that Ravage off cooldown for so long. It's like seeing an Enigma holding onto his black hole and not using it despite the fact that it's a free kill whenever you use it. You know, even if you only catch one hero, it's still fine.
Did you see him just then?
Is he faking it?
He gushed the Marana and faked the Ravage twice. Marana's like, oh god, oh god.
Marana's so squishy, does not want to be giving up a solo kill up to a Tidehunter. Meanwhile, Coast did take the tier 1 tower at top, and it looks like they're going to be making more rotations as they head for the middle lane.
It does give the top lane a little bit more room to breathe. Dread is up here leeching experience, but Timber Saw, where are you going to head now? Surely this is perfect timing for him to farm up top lane and get something. Going for an urn, possibly, on that Timber Saw?
Yeah, urn is a really good item for him, just because it gives him the little bit extra strength stats Radiant's that I believe Timber Saw does need. I think you need something small like that to help you out. And then obviously the regen and the sustainability offered to you by urn is really helpful as well, so I think that's a pretty smart decision. We do have the middle tier 1 tower taking a lot of damage so far, as Coast just feeling free to group up. Dire's bottom tower. They've got some of their big ultimates up anyway, so if they manage to catch somebody out with a glimpse here, turn it into a Static Storm, easy pickoff that claims the tier 1 tower.
Now, you know your mid game is going to be hell as Relax, but you know that the late game is almost definitely secured with that Morphling Midas. As a Marana, Midas as well?
No.
Do you go for a dual Midas and try and farm up as much as possible? No, he goes for drums, okay.
Yeah, I agree with that decision. I don't think you want to be getting anywhere near that. Go for the early stat, the early game items. So your drums, your Ring of Akilla, just those basic stat items that make you that much stronger at 15 minutes. Because I think you're going to need as much fighting power as humanly possible in order, because you can't just let all of your towers fall. Like, you could afford to let some of the tier 1 towers go down, maybe even your safe lane tier 1 tower if you're getting a decent exchange for it, but eventually Coast is going to start pushing in those tier 2s and you're going to have to fight. You're going to be forced into a position, and like you were saying earlier, Morphling is going to be at that point. Right as these pushes start coming in, Morphling is at a point where he doesn't do much. Like, all he does is split push. He doesn't have any real big damage up. He doesn't even have the Ethereal Blade by that time. Doesn't even have the levels for a big nuke, so Morphling is going to be essentially just like a Weaver. in many ways, where he can come up for just cleanup, but you're going to have to rely on your four other heroes to actually win the fight for you.
Yeah, it's just a shame they don't have any real big AoE team fights. They're going to have to rely very heavily on basically guerrilla warfare, hit and run as much as possible. If they can get Coast into a choke point that favors Relax, Timbersaw can do plenty of damage and, you know, destroy the Disruptor and Treant. I'm just worried about their damage output again. I think they just have to try and bait the Morphling as much as they can. Like, if they have the Morphling pushing a lane and force Coast into trying to engage on him 3v1, relocate Timbersaw and have Mirana use Moonlight Shadow and counter-initiate, I think that's going to be a lot more favorable than Relax trying to look for team fights or try and defend their towers in open areas. Radiant's
bottom tower is under that attack. Makes sense. Your traditional like defend tower scenarios are where Tidehunter is the strongest usually.
Yeah, like this tier one, they can't really come down here and defend. Radiant's so five man up top lane, have Morphling on the front lines. Dire's top
tower is under attack. Trying to take down that tier one tower. Living Armor is delaying them quite a bit right now, which means we're going to have a favorable trade for Coast. They force out a glyph, and glyph on both sides, actually. Now, damn, Living Armor coming in. Timbersaw gonna try and catch out. He skills, but kills the Forge Spirit. Backs away. Tier 1 tower did finally go down at bottom, and the Tidehunter does have his blink off of that one. That's the one thing I really like to see, is the fact they forced down all these Tier 1 towers so quickly. Now we have the teleports coming in. Shachlo trying to get himself away. The Cold Snap is just tearing him a new one. He cannot get away with the Timber Chain. Constantly being interrupted. Solon trying to get in range for catching one of these heroes, but I think overall, Relax did the smart thing there. Timbersaw played a little bit too aggressive there and got caught, but for the most part, they did a great job disengaging.
And it's so difficult when you're trying to trade towers against a damn Treant.
Yeah.
That Living Armor from across the map while they're pushing a tier one.
Arrow. Oh, yeah, that was real close. E skills. By the way, you notice the Morphling build? Looks like he's going for an early BKB.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, especially against the Disruptor, the Static Storm will wreck you.
Well, you know, there's Overgrowth, Static Storm, Ravage, Cold Snap, Deafening Blast. There's so many things that are going to piss that Morphling off.
Arrow, once again. Ooh, lined by that Invoker again. Meanwhile, the Tier 2 tower is going to go down at top. Coast completely uncontested in that one, and nothing big being gained by Relax. Like, the only thing they really have is the middle lane is a farm battle back and forth. Nobody's dying one way or the other. So really, just comes down to Yoki free farming in exchange for them claiming a tier 2. That's not going to be a great trade. Yoki may go down here as the Sunstrike does a large amount of damage there, but fortunately the Strength Morph is going to be good enough for now. But he needs to be able to get to his Replicate. He's going to be caught out. There goes the Replicate. May still be able to catch him with the Glimpse, sending him all the way back in. Now the Quick Teleport, though. The Static Storm goes out. They don't have anything to stop him, though. No more stuns. So that means a Ravage and a Static Storm both being used there in their attempt to get that Morphling. Big waste there from Coast. Should have realized that a Morphling, especially now that he's got the maxed out stat gain, that they just can't kill him. Not with just those two heroes.
And he created so much space as well. Like, there's room for Dread now to farm mid lane. On top, Timbersaw farmed up. He's now got 700 gold on top of the Urn and Arcanes. Relocate bot.
Yeah, seeing if they can catch out that a Disruptor should be fairly easy, but as I say that, sending the Morphling back, and now it's actually up to Winnex trying to hide himself in the side here. Should be able to rely on the Relocate to get him out back to safety. So, good attempt, but unfortunately, Disruptor, unless you have a real good amount of burst damage from that Morphling, like, once he has the Ethereal Blade, you can make those kind of plays. But for now, Morphling has too little burst and too much damage over time for them to try and pick off a Disruptor with that.
I was just wondering, if you take the Mirana rather than the Morphling with you, that was almost a sure kill.
Yeah, they're going out on Ape Mother right now, but he does have the Mac as well as the Living Armor, keeping him alive. The problem is, he has that constant slow coming at him. Solon's also going to be picked off here as he tried to defend his ally. The really obnoxious Morphling Viper situation, where Viper isn't actually taking much damage from it, but the Corrosive Skin constantly proccing on the Viper because of the illusion is a big issue, because he's just constantly slowed down. You saw the Viper was just slowing down to a crawl, and that was purely because of Corrosive Skin.
Dire's middle tower has fallen. Well, where was the rest of his team doing that? Disruptor, was he still like running around, Steph style, nowhere to be seen. Yeah, they've got these big ultimates, Overgrowth and Static Storm is off cooldown now. That was a perfect opportunity to basically bring it. Ravage is off is on cooldown for another 10 seconds, so they might be waiting for that.
Yeah, maybe they're just not willing to fight without the Ravage. Just kind of being like, you know what? That will guarantee we win the team fight. Otherwise, we just play around it. At least for now. Viper is working towards his Ags. Is about another 1,300 gold away from that one. E-Skills is going for Necrobook 3. And Solon, well, he doesn't have much yet. Picked up his Blink Dagger not too long ago. But hey, Rubik's got a Blink Dagger. Even better chance of a stolen Ravage.
Yep. Okay, I'll give you that now.
Mm-hmm. Uh-oh.
It's stealing time.
Uh-oh. Wolf has Timbersaw was just sent back to the bottom lane. He has to run all the way back, and he's using all of his mana to get there. That was unfortunate. Freegalit with a great glimpse there.
Can they defend this?
It would be up to the Chakram, right? Throwing out the Chakram and some of the Starstorm damage to quickly clear through the creeps, but because of that glimpse play, they don't have the Timbersaw yet. He's going to be healing up right now, but already there's been too much damage on this tier 3 tower.
And a big problem is the Morphling has BKB, but once that Ravage happens, Morphling, if he has BKB on, he's going to be focused down so quickly, or they're going to focus down the rest of his team, you know, before they can react. So either way, they're going to lose their carry, or they're going to lose four members of their team, leaving the Morphling alone, who has to run away. But it looks like Coast are going to take the safe option, return to farming. Try and gain some more map control because top tier one.
They're going to try and jump in here with the Morphling. This is really greedy of them, though. They're running right into a Ravage if they do something like that. That was... I have no idea what they were thinking there. They saw one teleport, but just one. That's not enough for them to force a fight. What they really need right now is Rubik to steal living armor. They lost so much in that tier 3 tower getting so low. It's practically dead. 140. They can actually deny it right now if they wanted to. Obviously, you don't want to deny tier 3 towers, but it goes to show like the small things like them not being in a great position, the Timbersaw being sent back so far into the bottom lane. Like those small things result in a ton of damage going on that tower. And now it's going to go down soon. The next push coming out from Coast will eliminate it. They really needed to be able to steal that living armor. I think that's your only recovery mechanism. Now you're just gambling it all on one team fight that you don't want to take yet.
And there's Necro 3 finished for the Invoker.
That's a large amount of damage. Some of these heroes are tough to be able to pick off. Tame Eyewild is able to get the leap away. So he'll be fine. Necronomicon minion being popped by Tame Eyewild. Now the Moonlight Shadow goes out. But the Mirana has to go back to the fountain. I think that was just them trying to force Coast back while Mirana heals.
A really good scare tactic, though.
Indeed.
It definitely worked.
It bought them a lot of time. But what's stopping Coast here from just sitting back and waiting for the Necronomicon minions to come back up?
Do they desperately need them? They've still got Forge Spirits. They've still got Ravage, Overgrowth, Static Storm.
They've got an
Observer Ward on the high ground as well, watching all of Relax's movements.
I think if they don't play with the Necronomicon minions, they play it carefully. It's fine if you try and go uphill a little bit. Just don't overly commit yourself. Because, you know, the trade-off being, what's waiting 30 more seconds? Like, are they really going to get any big change in items in 30 seconds? Highly unlikely. You know,
I can't believe that Sentry Ward placement. Literally just catching that Observer Ward.
Oh, man. It almost got the other ward, too. You see that?
Yeah. That's the thing. If it had been over to catch the other... Oh. Do they have a gem? No, they placed a Sentry themselves. Yeah. These odd-looking birdie wards.
I like the ward fish. That one's the best.
There was someone in a game earlier who had an Octopus Ward. I'd never seen that before.
Oh, yeah. It's always the pro players who bring out like the new items for the first time.
Yeah, they get them secretly. Closed doors cosmetics.
Look at that. The new coming out from the Morphling did literally nothing to Tame Mother. Now the Ravage is going to go out. Going to be able to catch out Tame My Wild. Dread unable to intercept the Ravage there. And that means he won't be able to steal it. Anchor Smash has already gone down. Shotchlo in the middle of all these heroes gets cleaned up real quickly. Yoki popping the BKB. Trying to finish off E-Skills. Unable to get it. And the mech now comes out. Shotchlo with the buyback. Gotta go for the... Oh, man. He gets sent back. He was getting so close to the Invoker, too. Could have been able to pick up that kill, but the very good reaction there from the Disruptor once again glimpsing him back.
Such a difficult scenario to be in as Coast. Do we go for the ranged racks and be safe, or do we try and nuke down the melee racks as quickly as possible? They got that melee racks down to, what, 170 health, but now it's regening up so quickly. That could have all been for nothing.
Well, they did force out a buyback on the Timber Stomp, and they did get themselves a lot of extra gold. Like, the Invoker was sitting at something like 3,300, 3,500 gold. He just picked up a 4-staff. The Disruptor looks like he's eventually going to be building into Ags, but he's not going to have that anytime soon. Viper finished up his Ags recently, so he's not getting anything new. The Tidehunter can grab something if he wants to. Maybe 4-staff. I always like extra mobility items on Tidehunter.
Rubik has Overgrowth.
That's not a bad spell to deal. Glimpse back, unfortunate situation there.
To the same spot he was in already?
Yeah. One of those scenarios where you don't actually know where he was 5 seconds ago, and you're like, oh, now I look silly. Yoki's trying to build up some of that physical damage, man, but he just does not compare. These heroes are too tanky and they have too much sustain. Like, even if they do start taking him down, like, half health or something, Leech Seed, Mech, the Living Armor, all these things start kicking in that make it impossible to be able to finish off one hero.
Kraken Shell, Stout Shield.
Yeah. Damage block doing work.
Like, if the Tide was going 4-staff, he probably would have it by now. Do you reckon Shiva's and he goes Mystic Staff first? Refresher, possibly? Or do you go for something like Vlad's, where you are committing to pushing up to high ground right now? You've tried it twice at mid and succeeded somewhat. Smoke from Relax.
I don't actually like the refresher this early, but we'll see. I would kind of actually prefer the Shiva's. I think that item would be a little bit more effective in these team fights, as it comes online a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
But Arrow's going to come out. Gonna just hit the Forge Spirit. Ape Mother is willing to sit here. He's really, really tanky. Ravage is gonna go off. BKB is activated by Tame My Wild in time. However, already they're down at West. Shotchlo also trying to position himself. Great overgrowth. They're gonna be able to do a lot of damage here with this Chakram, but it's just not enough, man. They're too tanky. Dread's gonna be caught out. They do have the vision to be able to reveal him. Now the Glimpse send back. Tame My Wild does get a leap away, but he's already slowed up by the Leech Seed. Oh, the last poison attack catches him. He's so damn fast, though. Look at him go with the drums being activated. Solan catches up, though, and the Gush will be able to finish him off. And that means Coast, they can either go straight through middle and force the buyback out of the Marana, or they kit the Aegis and then go mid. Either way is a strong play one way or another. Looks like they want the Aegis, though. Scythe of Ice could be the next item choice for Invoker, but I doubt we're going to get that late.
I think once they push down mid to get to about here, Mirana's alive in, what, 20 seconds or so? So once they get here, she's alive in 10 seconds. I don't think it's really worth trying to force that buyback because she's not going to do it anyway. She'll just be waiting for herself to revive while the rest of her team postures and tries to hold them off. Smoke from Coast here as well. How long until Ravage is back? A minute and 15?
Yeah, they just had that Aegis picked up by Ape Mother, so if they wanted to, they can send like the minions, the Necronomicon minions, the Forge Spirits, and Ape Mother, all sitting in front, all beating on the range racks. I don't think they could go for the melee racks anymore. It's practically been healed up all the way. And sure enough, the surprise push comes in. Ape Mother already going uphill. The Glimpse back, but a quick blink away from Dread before the tick of damage comes in.
If only he had hit him once and then ulted.
Yeah, if only, but the teleports, man. They do have a relocate from this Wisp and Morphling. They're just waiting for the opportunity to make the jump in. Glyph being activated, they both came back into the space. Now Shotchlo, they need to provide some sort of interference here, but already the melee racks has gone down. And Coast used nothing for it.
Morphling and Wisp had a bit of free farm time, but they still came back to this mid lane to defend nothing. Like, they should have just stayed top, surely. Tried to do as much damage to that tier 2 as possible. Try and get as much as they can on that Morphling, who's desperately trying to grasp at a Manta style. Now, this Mirana needs something heavy hitting very soon. One thing, though, worthy of pointing out, relax. The longer this game goes, the more chance they have of winning. Viper isn't a great late game carry. Invoker, you know, he does well until, what, 45, 50 minutes in? Titan's a Treant Disruptor, very teamfight oriented. Once the enemy has BKBs, mech, pipe, all of these big items, there's very little they can do. So this Morphling, Timbersaw, Wisp, Mirana scale very well.
But sweet Jesus, are we casting China? What the hell is going on here? I just realized we've only had 8 kills in 28 minutes.
What?
Like, am I just doomed to have these kind of games all day long? Is that what's happening? Man.
Well, that's, so much is on the line. You can't play risky Dota, can you?
You've got to be methodical.
You've got to be calm. You've got to queue up, wait in line. Put on your monocle, have a cup of tea.
Well, Coast are going to feel a little bit silly if they do something similar to Aware last game and just kind of stall this game out until all of a sudden the big carries come online and they're like, oh, whoops, should have pushed in a little bit sooner.
They've already taken one melee Rax. They've got tier 2 bot, which is probably going to be their...
True. They're already miles ahead of what Aware were doing last game.
Yeah, exactly. They've got one tier 2 of bot lane, which is, you know, free gold in their pockets, pretty much, if they start pushing there now, which they probably will do.
What the hell is Shotchlo doing? I guess he's building into a BKB because he kind of has to against the Disruptor. It just sucks. You still have to deal with the Viper ultimate.
Yeah.
Oh, Solon coming in from the side here. He does have a Ravage. Moonlight Shadow's going to go out. The Wisps are already being blown up. The Dust does catch the Mirana, but already teleports himself away. And Shotchlo will be able to do the same here in the corner. So just a simple Wisp pick off. He will be back up in time for defense of the base. And Coast now looking to take the last tier 2 and maybe start threatening this bottom lane.
Will we see a Ravage steal from Dread? I'm just waiting for him to prove me wrong.
How many Ravages have we had so far?
Like two?
Two, yeah. So if he gets it on the third one, guess what? That means he's got a 33%.
Radiant's bottom tower has fallen. That's what I'm worried about.
Waiting for me to prove you wrong. Yeah, or he doesn't get one, Coast end the game, and he gets a 0%.
That's close enough to 5.
Close enough.
I wonder, can Nahas find that kind of stat? How many Ravages have been stolen compared to how many Ravages have been cast against Rubick? Whoa, Treant.
I don't know. Gets picked off, I guess, by the arrow. That was a little interesting there. Not sure
Arrow,
what his plan
Starstorm.
You figure a big tanky hero like Treant Protector would be all right, but apparently not.
Lightning pretty much wrecks trees, huh?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Well, there's a slight advice on the Invoker. Still no Boots of Travel, and when they're trying to push and counter-push as quickly as possible, I think Boots of Travel will be his next item of choice. How close is this tied to Refresher? Why can't I select the damn courier? There we go.
He's got it.
Wow, that's how close he is. Oh, okay.
That's how close. So, it's always the measurement game. So, 400, 600, 825 mana he needs for the double Ravage.
Just enough.
Plus, he's got Arcane Boots as well, so.
Yeah, Arcane, Refresh, Arcane, Magic Wand. He's got plenty of mana.
Yeah.
But he has to use Anchor Smash after both Ravages. He has to. Well, no, he has to use it after the second one. He definitely has to use it after the second one. The first one doesn't matter so much as long as he catches the Rubick. Rubick has living armor. Dire's top tower is under attack. Your dream has come true.
Just
10 minutes too late.
Yeah. Tier 3 tower already dead. Well, this bottom tier 3 tower is yet to take any damage. Co-star centering up for it. They're going to wait for it. I love the way they're using these smokes to go in for like these real quick Blitzkriegs type pushes. Right? Like, all of a sudden you're like, where Coast? Oh my god, they're taking down our tier 3 tower. We're not in a position to be able to defend it. And it's going to fall. Already, the teleports are coming back, but they're not going to be here in time. Melee Rax is going to go down soon. Glyph being forced out and relaxed. Now going to have to charge in if they want to be able to chase away Coast. Ravage going off. It's going to be able to catch out 3 here. Dread snags Anchor Smash. Damn it. He didn't get it. Solon now is going to be able to make his way away. BKB's activated. Left and right by Relax as they get themselves away. Dread being caught out by the Dust is going to be ticking out. The Wisp trying to heal him up, but the right click damage too strong. Now the slow going out. Buyback coming out. There's a second Ravage to be deployed here from Solon. And again, steals the Viper Strike. I hope he realizes the Refresher was used by Solon. Now another Ravage goes in. Dread, this time not going to be able to steal it again either. Yoki's going to get picked off. The Relocate going to be too slow. Windex survives himself. But unable to save the Morphling there. That weird glimpse sent back. Awkward.
What the hell was that?
E-Skills trying to walk away with his Ghost Walk. Barely on the edge of that counter ward. Does get zapped down. Arrow. Oh, wait, Mother. Teleporting away just in time.
Can we just rewind and watch that glimpse again?
Like, that Wispball was like...
What was this?
Whoop. I guess he was trying to follow with the Timber Chaining Timber Saw, but...
At first, I thought he glimpsed the Mirana or someone, because I saw the Mirana leap like this and walk like this. So I thought, oh, that must be it. Mm-hmm. But no. The odd mechanics of Dota 2. I guess it tries to track his position, and he moves positions so quickly, it only takes, like a mean position per given time period.
Morphling. He's getting bigger, man. I mean, they're on the edge. Like, relax, I've already lost pretty much two racks down, right? Two racks down are kind of like the standard general Dota GG. Like, you can't come back from two racks down very easily. But Yoki's getting big. He's got a Manta, he's got the BKB, now has an Ultimate Orb possibly going into the Scotty as a late game item. Tame by Wild, not having so much damage right now. He's got a lot because of the double damage, but other than that, his actual items, fairly limited. They can draw this game out for another 5, maybe 7, 8 minutes. I think they've got themselves a pretty good chance of actually being able to start combating Coast. Like, this Viper will start dropping off eventually, man. Eventually.
Well, yeah, they've got 3 BKBs now as well, and they've never managed to take a decent team fight because Tide got his double Ravage with that Refresher at the perfect time and made some massive plays, blinking back in that second time to catch the Morphling, got hexed up, taken out of the fight. I think the next upcoming fights, like you said, in the next 5 to 10 minutes, these BKBs are going to be much, much stronger.
The question is whether or not they can get them off, man. They just, last time, the Ravage initiation caught them off guard. Once again, they're going to go for a smoke, though. Maybe it's time for a little bit of an upset. Maybe somebody else is going to be initiated on. Relax, leading. Yoki's going to be spied up here by Steph Style. And they realize what's happening. Initiation from the side. Moonlight Shadow's going to go out. They're going to go on Yoki immediately. Ravage blown up. Now he's gone. They're counter-Ravage, though. Both Ravages going off at the same time. But it's still going to be a lost team fight without the damage of the Morphling. There's no way they can contest this. Here comes Shotchlow. They actually canceled the teleport there. Tame by Wild wants to go for the kill on Freegly, but he may regret that. He's being held up by Ape Mother, trying to turn around, deal damage. He's doing a decent amount there, but not enough to win this. Maybe he can. Arrow goes out, gets the kill, double kill from Tame by Wild, and maybe he doesn't regret canceling that teleport in favor of trying to go on the Disruptor. Disruptor does live, and so does the other support in the Terrain Protector, but that was still, I mean, I thought with the Morphling getting taken out of that fight immediately, I thought, no way is Relax going to win that team fight, but
that
the counter
steal from Dread was so clutch.
That and the double Ravage, they went off at the exact same time. That was like the weirdest thing I've ever seen. Mixed in with that glimpse ball moving around, this game has been a game for weird firsts.
That's the thing, Invoker never actually managed to get some big combos off. I think he dropped Meatball. But apart from that, the Hex on the Morphling was the only big thing he did. He actually bought back, didn't he?
Oh, they're going to Sunstrike. Oh, Tame My Wild's already healed up too much.
Yes. Is that a yes to me saying he bought back? I think it is.
Who, what, when, where, why, what?
Nahan's just said yes, and I'm not sure if you're saying yes to me. Oh, Invoker bought back. Thank you. Yeah.
The Mjolnir, man. That Mjolnir did some serious work. I was actually thinking, Mjolnir, Roshan, right, being your main source of damage for the Mirana, going up against a Viper, who has a ton of tank, and he's got corrosive skin. I was like, no, you can't possibly do enough damage to one-on-one the Viper, man, but he just crushed him. Like, those lightning procs were actually still chunking down the Viper, despite the fact that he has all that magic resistance.
Well, yeah, when you look at the bonus damage it gives as well, Mirana has the same base damage as the Viper right now, but plus 84 from that Mjolnir BKB. Mm-hmm. Well, face boots and drums as well, but, you know. Now, that smoke was interesting. Timbersaw not caught in it. Oh. That's not the real Viper. Well,
they should have known that, but oh well. Maybe they just wanted to kill the replicant really badly. Really badly.
Mantis-style illusions. Damn you. Oh, Ags.
Ooh, yep.
Oh, here we go. So those BKBs I thought would get a little bit stronger. If Disruptor gets this big static storm off, it's going to be hell and pain for Relax.
At the same time, they do have some ways to be able to save, or at least one way, right? The Wisp relocate. If he does not get caught in the Disruptor, in that Disruptor ult, he can come in and use the relocate to pull them out of it.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably going to be your best bet to try and save the Morphling if he's caught in it.
Oh, we've got Blink on the train as well. How long has he had that for?
Well, it looks like he's picking up a Force Staff afterwards, so probably last couple minutes.
Force Staff or Necro?
I normally would not say Necro for the train protector, but they do need to go for that extra bit of pushing power.
Yeah. I'm in the same boat as you. I would say initially Force Staff, but the way they're playing and they've committed so much, they need to take this last lane. They need that extra little bit.
Yeah, and we're getting to a point where, honestly, like, even going into late game, when you have the two racks advantage, it doesn't matter necessarily if you do have a push lineup that kind of falls off, because you only need that one last set of racks. You could do so much extra with the push lineups. If you do get those kind of, like, mass Necronomicons, you could start sieging down the tower, all those sorts of things. So
can they actually siege this tower, though?
Yeah, Relax are starting to position themselves a little bit more aggressively. They're not going to let this Tier 3 tower just get beat on so much. And as I say that, Tier 3 tower going to get beat on and taken down. Arrow going to be able to catch the Forge Spirit. They need to jump in soon here. Like, they're losing a lot of ground. Bottom's going to push in soon. Middle's pushing in as well. When they have these five heroes grouped up, and like this, they have to actually make the jump. Timbersaw going in deep here with his BKB active. Whoa there, that was Shotslow jumping the gun there. Nobody else was following him into that.
Meanwhile, bot ranged and mid-tier fours, their base is completely open.
Yeah, Relax are playing this really, really sloppy now. Looks like the Marauder was able to get caught by the Glimpse sendback. Immediate buyback from him. But I think they can still go in with Timbersaw being occupied at the bottom lane, some heroes being occupied by mid. They still have this Aegis as well for the Invoker. Aye, Living Armor was stolen. They could just keep the Tier 3 tower alive, though. It's not going to happen. Manta Illusions being enough. Nice use of the Manta, though, to dodge that Viper strike.
How long does this morph have on his BKB? 7 seconds? Mirana, 6? Timbersaw's is relatively new, 7 on him as well. So they're not at that point quite yet where they're low enough for Coast to just roll over them, but it's getting close.
Yeah, they need to just jump in. They gotta go in for this already. The range racks has gone down. Now the Ravage are gonna go out. Wisp getting caught in that one as well. Shocklow and the rest of the BKBs are going to be activated here, but they're still being held in place by the Overgrowth. Now they're going to be able to start turning some of this damage, going to work on these heroes, taking them down bit by bit. The Invoker goes down. He does have the Aegis coming back up. Disruptor gets caught in the side. E-Skill should go down again here, but pops the Ghost. Oh, no. They only had the one counter ward being laid down. It wasn't in time to disable him before he gets away. Ghost walks himself out of there. Two heroes being picked off, plus the Aegis. Not worth it, as they're only left with the melee racks at top lane now.
They had a couple of others on Dread, but that Rubick slowed down so much by Ghostwalk, he couldn't get there in time.
And this is what really gets me here. Did Relax grab anything? From the time the Coast started setting up on that Tier 3 tower, did Relax get anything since between that point in time and them forcing the fight? I don't think they did.
Item-wise, or...?
Yeah, item-wise. Like, did anything significant change for Relax that gave them an advantage that they didn't have before?
Oh.
That's the thing that bugs me. They were able to take the team fight, but instead they just let themselves get sieged down, and now they're left extremely exposed. There's only a melee Rax left. That is so hard to come back from when it only takes just a little bit of backdoor to get those mega creeps that are tough to be able to deal with. So, if they've just been able to try and force that fight earlier, and they win it, or at least come out even, they keep their Tier 3 alive, they're less exposed.
But how do you force a fight onto Coast? in that situation, when they're sat up here with, you know, Tide over here and Voka pushing down here, how do you get out of your base without smoking and going around and being very obvious about it because you've got lanes of creeps, you know, in your base already? There's no way you can go down a ramp and then up a ramp without Coast, you know, just swarming on you and having a massive concave and, you know, ripping you to shreds?
I think the only option here is just relocate from behind while three heroes go front. You know, have the Morphling and then the Wisp go in from behind. We have the BKBs being activated, Coast being torn into a new one. Relaxed, getting on the aggressive style. However, they're going to lose their Morana. That's a main source of damage there. Timbersaw still in the back trying to do what work he can. Ravage is going to be able to cut it, caught it, and stole it. By Dread, turns it around. Here comes the Morphling, going on the Steph style. We'll be able to take him out, but the Scythe of Ice holding him in place. Now he's actually in some trouble as he's being focused down, trying to get away. He doesn't have a waveform. He's going to be taken out here in just a second. Waveform can't get it. Taken down, and GG well play is called as their big carry goes down. At least they tried to force the fight. They knew they couldn't let Coast try and go uphill. They try and surprise him with the team fight. Doesn't work out for them. In the end, Coast do win yet another match, man. Coast doing work. Monomaniac Esports. A lot of people called them as the big, like, dark horse for the tournament. And they started out day one looking very, very strong.
Yeah, definitely. And it's not just, you know, highly skilled players. They're working really well as a team, coordinating all of these skills. I think in this match, Tidehunter definitely star of the show. There are a couple of nice glimpses from the Disruptor. But Tidehunter perfectly timed Ravages, not using Refresher instantly after his first Ravage all the time, which, you know, it would seem logical to do, but he doesn't always want to burst that mana out. He wants to have Gush and Anchor Smash sometimes. Mm-hmm. But really nice to see them play.
Yeah, very, very well done. Coast right now are sitting at 4-1. Only being beaten by Mouse Sports. Now, they have yet to play some of the bigger teams. Roxkiss and Power Rangers are still on their to-be-played list. But, gotta say, Team Coast, they could be, I'm thinking they're going to be able to clinch their way into the playoffs rather easily here, and they could be a contender here for that second-place slot. I gotta say, I love watching their play style. I think that a lot of small things like the smoke being used in order to get those surprise blitz pushes into the towers, I think in general, I think you just called it perfectly. Their coordination in these team fights was just superb. So, Coast, very fun team to watch, guys. We're going to have another small break. Fortunately, that game was long enough that we won't have too much of a break. Next up is going to be our last match of the night, and it is going to be Aware versus Mouse. And that's going to be starting in 20 minutes' time. So I lied about the long break. Sorry. Stick around, guys. We'll play some music, though, and we'll be back with our last game of the night for the TI4 European Qualifiers.